Well, good morning, and lovely to see you. Well done making it through the damp to be here. I particularly felt for my daughter today. She had a camping trip last night with Duke of Edinburgh. And, I think they had the day hiking yesterday was in the dry, but a very soggy start this morning. Anyway, she's currently drying out at home, along with the tent. But anyway, lovely to see you here. Lovely to have Sarah here with us. I think Sarah's got as busy morning as me with reading and playing and everything else. But no, it's good to be together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
So to our first hymn, and we stand as we're in. To purify ourselves before our holy God. Christ died to sin once for all, and now he lives to God. Let us renew our resolve to have done with all that's evil and confess our sins in penitence and faith. Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you feed us with the living bread. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
So may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
So our collect for this fifth Sunday of Easter, let us pray. Risen Christ, your wounds declare your love for the world and the wonder of your risen life. Give us compassion and courage to risk ourselves for those we serve, to the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
Please do sit for our readings.
The first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go towards the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home seated in his chariot. He was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to this chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open its mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
and a reading from the first letter of John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. As we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Saviour of the world, God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment. And whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord.
So we come now to our gradual hymn before we hear our gospel. I don't know how familiar this is to everyone, and we were having that conversation before the service. It's a fun one because the words vary quite a lot from verse to verse in terms of how you fit them in. So let's just go for it.
Thank you, sir.
It'll be fun. Let's stand to sing with joy.
Come to me, but thou.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I've spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the gospel of the Lord. Alleluia.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Hallelujah. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our hearts be now and always acceptable to you, Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Gaza. I wonder whether for you, as for me, it was that single word which stood out from today's readings. Acts chapter 8, verse 26. Then an angel of the Lord said to Philip, get up and go towards the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road. It's a verse that we'd normally skip over. They're simply to give some context to the drama that follows, earthing in reality what might otherwise seem an unlikely or apocryphal tale. The way it's told, today's account from the Acts of the Apostles has strong echoes of the resurrection narratives, in which Jesus suddenly appears in the garden, in a locked room, along the Emmaus Road, on the seashore, and then just as suddenly disappears. That seems reasonable for someone risen from the dead, inhabiting a resurrection body, already beyond our everyday understanding of how things are supposed to work, beyond our comprehension. But here we have one of Jesus' disciples, Philip, reading that at the close of his encounter with the Ethiopian eunuch, the Spirit snatches him away. The eunuch seeing him no more, whilst Philip inexplicably finds himself in Azotus. To our modern ears, it sounds like science fiction, akin to teleporting. Frankly, we can't know the truth of it, although I favour the explanation that Luke, the author collecting these stories, is simply recording Philip's account as best he could. Namely, that Philip is so in the spirit that he couldn't recall or fathom quite how he got to Azotus, underscoring the miraculous nature of the encounter that had just taken place. But back to Gaza and to the wilderness road. Gaza is an ancient city on the eastern shore of the Mediterranean Sea, a little way to the south of Azotus, which itself was a short hop along the coast from Caesarea Philippi. Gaza, so named by its inhabitants, the Canaanites, literally meaning strength in that ancient Semitic language, in reference to it being a fortified or walled city, providing security for its inhabitants. The Egyptians corrupting its name to Gazat, meaning prized and equally out. The famous Madaba map, a 6th century floor mosaic depicting the Holy Land, refers to Gaza as the 7th oldest city in the world, a place with a wealth of history and archaeology, and an extremely fruitful place with a favourable climate, bejewelled for many centuries by orchards with citrus fruits, vines, figs, and pomegranates. And as we've come to learn via news bulletins, bordered to the south by Khan Yunus, which translates into Caravanserai of Jonah. Khan, Caravanserai, Yunus, Jonah. Historically a place of refreshment for those journeying along the coast road. Named, it seems, after Jonah of Nineveh fame, who, if he lived there, perhaps had a special place in his heart for fellow travellers after his own long, arduous and eventful trip. However fanciful that might sound, it seems reasonably likely that Khan Yunus might have been the immediate destination for our Ethiopian eunuch, a welcome stop on his long journey home from Jerusalem. Watching the news about life in Gaza day after day, I confess I hadn't considered its history. And learning something of this makes the destruction yet more awful. Imagine this were another historic walled city like Jerusalem, Chester, or York. The way from Jerusalem to Gaza, as our Bible reading tells us, was along a wilderness road, along many miles of rocky and uninhabited terrain. Not unlike the setting that Jesus chose for his best-known parable of the Good Samaritan. We're told an angel prompts Philip to go to this wilderness road, and that Philip obeys, despite it being a fearful and unpromising place in its nature. What unfolds is a wonderful model or template for how evangelism and discipleship should be done. First, it follows the Spirit's prompting. And Philip's obedient, despite the risks and unlikely location for anything worthwhile to happen. He's obedient again to be courageous enough to go up to this chariot. Are we obedient to the Spirit's prompting? Do we allow time and space to hear the voice of the Spirit? Are we open to that possibility? Do we pray that God would use us, would put people along our path during the day with whom we might share the love of God, might share the good news that's in us? Philip then engages with a man who's clearly already spiritually searching. He's a God-fearer who recognises the spiritual truths at the heart of the Jewish faith, perhaps with links to the thriving Jewish community in Ethiopia at that time. And it's an amazing opening. Just so happens to be reading that particular scripture. And a further sign that God is already at work. Philip begins the encounter with a helpful question. Do you understand what you're reading? It's a wonderful open question, no hint of condescension, an implied invitation within it, which leads this Ethiopian eunuch to invite Philip in return to come alongside him. And of course, Philip willingly accepts. He's willing to travel with him. Then there are further questions from the Ethiopian about whom is the prophet saying this. And Philip now has the opportunity to share the good news of Jesus Christ. But notice he doesn't rush. He meets the man where he is, beginning from that point, and then patiently telling the whole story from there. And note that throughout the whole encounter, Philip never has to push. He simply takes the opportunities that are presented to him. The Spirit is clearly at work. Note that the suggestion of baptism also comes from this man rather than from Philip. And that the result is rejoicing, a sign that along with being spiritually cleansed, this Ethiopian is baptized into new life of the Spirit. Of course, there's no way that Philip could have foreseen the impact of this single encounter. The fruit that being faithful to Jesus and guided by Christ's Spirit would bear. Fact is, Christianity in Africa has very deep roots. Europeans were not the first to bring this gospel. The Coptic Church in Egypt and in Ethiopia, and now in Solihull, is extremely ancient, with this convert regarded in a way similar to how Syrian Orthodox Christians look to the disciple Thomas. And that should, I think, remember the impact of our own encounters and conversations, especially when we followed the Spirit's prompting, the Spirit's leading. And what does all this say about God and about mission? Well, of course, that it's God's mission, that God's Spirit goes before us, and that no one and nowhere is outside of God's reach, that God cares for the individual. Which brings us back to Gaza, to the many thousands who've lost their lives, to the more than 1 million people who've been displaced, to the hostages held now for more than 6 months. It is, of course, coincidence that Gaza is mentioned in our Bible reading today at this time when it's so prominent in our news. But that's not to say it's not timely. A timely reminder that no one and nowhere is beyond the reach of God. That even apparently small and inconsequential encounters will yield fruit when they're prompted by the Holy Spirit and are the result of our faithful obedience. That love is the only proper motivation for sharing our faith. That perfect love casts out fear, as we heard this morning. And that love has the power to bridge differences in race, in language, in gender, and in wealth. Just consider for a moment how different the life experiences of Philip and this Ethiopian eunuch must have been. The biblical account concluded with rejoicing, with good news, with hope. Let us pray that in God's timing this might extend also to Gaza, that by God's grace it would again reclaim its past and its name, offering strength and security to all its inhabitants, offering hospitality, a welcome to travellers and visitors from all backgrounds, regardless, that it might be a place of prosperity, justice and peace, viewed as a blessed place, a prize for all the right reasons. Before we pray, we're going to first affirm our faith in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please stand as we read. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen. So please do be seated for our prayers.
Let us pray. Dear Father God, we pray for our parish as we seek your guidance for the way forward in structure and staffing. Bless and guide those entrusted with leading this task. We pray that the process will soon come to a conclusion, enabling us to achieve a more stable base on which to build our fellowship and our outreach. We pray that some at least of those who have not felt able to return to Sunday worship after the disruption of the last few years will then feel able to do so. Bless Michael, our new bishop, as he starts his ministry here in Birmingham. May we all make him welcome and help him to work positively with all people in this diverse region. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for all candidates standing in the local elections this week. May they be motivated by care and concern for those they seek to represent, and work to achieve what is really needed rather than short-term political gain. May we all use our votes prayerfully. Jesus, Prince of Peace, we offer our earnest prayers for ongoing conflicts. Not just Gaza, but also Ukraine, where there seems no way that human intervention can either bring either conflict to any kind of a peaceful solution. And yet, within our living memory, situations that seemed equally intractable have been resolved, seemingly miraculously, showing that you can achieve the impossible if humans will only give you the chance. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Let us pray for all those who travel to this country seeking refuge from violence or poverty. May we see these as desperate human beings, and not just as a problem. May you guide our government to find the most effective ways of meeting both their interests and ours. Help us to be good neighbours to all those around us. May our lives demonstrate our Christian faith and God's love for all people. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Dear Jesus, the healer, we thank you for all those caring for the sick and vulnerable among us. Bless all those working in care homes and as home carers. May they show your love to everyone in their charge and feel your strengthening power when times are stressful. Let us pray for all who are sick, in body or mind, especially for any for whom we do have a personal concern, and for their family and friends. May they feel your love supporting and strengthening them. As a church family, we are asked to pray especially today for Michael Hicklin, one of our neighbours in St Helens Road, and for Barbara and Derek Sears while Derek is in hospital, not forgetting their son Nick, who also has health issues of his own. And let us, in a few moments of silence, bring before God any for whom we do have a personal concern. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Dear Father God, may all who have recently lost loved ones be comforted in the assurance of your love and care for those who have died. And in a few moments of silence, let us call to mind any whose memory is special to us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Again, invite us to stand as we're able. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share with each other a sign of God's peace. So to our offertory hymn, "Before the Throne of God."
Thank you.
Be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest. Make yourself known in the breaking of bread.
Amen.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night that he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voices to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Please do be seated as we continue in prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever." Lord, our hearts hunger with you. Give us this bread always. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Let's say together, Lord God, our Father, through our Saviour Jesus Christ, you have assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the depths of sin, and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God of truth, we have seen with our eyes and touched with our hands the bread of life. Strengthen our faith that we may grow in love for you and for each other. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, it's fantastic to see so many of you here today. And I saw a wonderful poster. So who's going to come and tell us all about it? Yeah. We'll bring the poster. Lovely. Yeah.
So we were talking about the I am sayings in John's Gospel, and we had some symbols in my bag, and the children were brilliant at knowing what they represented, so we thought we'd test Nick to see if he
okay.
gets any right. So let's see what we've got.
We just had I am the bread of life as a hymn, so that helps.
Right, I'll put that one back now.
I'm the good shepherd.
Excellent. Are you right? Yes. Right.
Oh. I'm the bread of life.
Excellent. Right, you're doing very well so far. You've got that one right. So I'm going to show everybody else this one.
I am the gate.
Excellent. Yeah, it's doing very well. You got that one as well. Right.
Oh, look at that. I think we should ask somebody else. Who else wants to have a go?
So it's an arrow. I am the way. Excellent.
The truth and the life, yes.
Yeah, the truth and the life. Right. Right, we've got a very small tea light. Anybody know this?
Who wants to do the tea light? I'm
You're
the light.
Go on then. Can you remember? The Son of God and I am the light. Of the world.
Well, yeah.
Excellent. And I think we've got one last one in here, which I think you would have been talking about.
Well, we focused on the Gaza reading, but...
Oh, did you? Well, there we
yes,
go.
Yes, we did have that reading. We had that gospel.
Had that
we did.
Anybody was listening.
Who was listening to the gospel reading? I am the vine.
Yeah.
You are the
branches. So we were talking about what would happen if the branches became separated from the vine, from the trunk, and they would die. So
yes.
We're talking about how we stay close to God by prayer and coming to church. And we've made this wonderful poster. Well, we say we, the children have made this wonderful poster, which said we are connected to God. And it's got all their names and their hands, which they've decorated.
They certainly have. They, well, it's fantastic. So, round of applause, I think. That's fantastic. Thank you.
Well done.
Brilliant. Lovely.
Right.
So, just to share a couple of notices before we conclude our service, the gospel today. Partly, as I said in my sermon earlier, it was the word Gaza that really sort of drew me into that reading from the Acts of the Apostles. But also, I was very conscious that I know that the bishop will preach about John 15 tonight, so that you could get both if you come then. So we have, Bishop Michael being welcomed at our deanery service of welcome. That's at 4 o'clock at St Alphage. So all the churches of the whole deanery being invited to come together for that service, a songs of praise. So please do come if you can, say 4 o'clock, St Alphage. It's going to be, as well as obviously having the bishop with us and hearing him speak, we are also going to have lots of lovely hymns, as you'd expect, with the songs of praise. And we have a deanery choir. So our musical director at St Alphage, Chris, who I'm sure many of you know, has been inviting and working with musicians, singers, and we're looking forward to all that that will bring to our worship this afternoon. Speaking of the bishop, later on into June, we have a confirmation service. I think it's the 23rd. 23rd of June, a confirmation service. Again, it's a deanery confirmation, but we're hosting at St Alphage. And we are looking forward to confirming, we think, quite a few young people and also some who are young in spirit, but perhaps older in years. The plan at the moment is to begin preparation. We always have confirmation preparation. So to begin that, we think on Pentecost, which is the 19th of May. So a few weeks away, but it'll be here soon. So anyway, I'm mentioning it really just to try and spread the word. There may be some of you here that are interested in being confirmed, and that's fantastic. It's for those of year six and up. So younger than that, we have First Communion, but it's for year six and up because it's about making that mature decision, that declaration of faith. So we have to be at least that old. But there is no upper age limit. I think in terms of me preparing candidates for confirmation, the oldest candidate I've ever prepared was in their 90s. I would love to have a centenarian, but that's not happened yet, but who knows. But as I say, it really is for everyone, and please do, you know, spread the word to others. Let others know who might be interested, just to get in touch, and then we'll plan the preparation together. Other notices. I had a phone call in the week from United Christian Broadcasters saying they would love to send us some of their magazines for free. So I never refuse things that are free. Well, I sometimes do, but this seemed like a good thing. And it's basically got lots of different readings and reflections and prayers and so on. So there are a pile of those that I brought with me this morning. So they're completely free. If you'd like one, please do take one. We also have out there, and again free, our reports for the annual meeting. So we had the annual meeting here on Monday, just gone. That was a lovely meeting, a good meeting, and there were lots of really good reports, really thoroughly talking about the life in our parish, reflecting on the year that's passed, as well as looking ahead. So if you haven't already had a copy of that report, you might have had it by email, or if you were here Monday, you might have been given one. But if you haven't had one, please do take one, just to read what's going on in the life of the parish, so we all feel, as we've heard this morning, connected. Which is important. The last notice I've got is just to say a little bit, as I'm here, I haven't been here for a couple of weeks, just about the scheme review. I won't go into great detail, but just want to let people know kind of what that means in sort of fairly straightforward terms, I hope. We have, as a PCC, elected to dissolve the scheme. Now, to be really clear, that is not about our district church councils or the way we work as districts. What that is about having set out a particular way of deployment. So saying that we would have team vicars and there would be this many, and also in terms of what the, if you like, the relationship or the power structure is between the rector and those team vicars. Recognising that actually it looks very different now, and there are other people as well who are licensed and called to ministry, including, of course, Suzette and Linda, Sue and so many others in different ways. It's a different world than when the scheme was written in 1970 something. So just to reiterate, we have dissolved the scheme, which basically is about that deployment of people because we work differently and more collaboratively. But what we've not done is to dissolve DCCs or districts or that way of operating. Those will continue. Yes, we will reflect on them and see if there's any ways that we can make them even better. And we will also be thinking about how in each place that we gather for worship, each community, if you like, and we are a community of communities, we will look to have a person that everybody can identify as their kind of missional and pastoral lead. So there's a kind of go-to person. So that's something that came through very clearly, that desire, through the consultation, and it has been heard. So we're going to be talking as a PCC and as leaders how we can make that happen. Anyway, I hope that for the large part that's reassuring. That's the way forward. And we were able to agree that unanimously as a church council, which again we felt was a real wonderful sign that we're being led by the Spirit. Well, let's stand together now for our closing hymn. O Jesus, I promise to serve thee to thee.
Able to stay for a bit and to share fellowship together. And so may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon each of us and all for whom we prayed, now and always.
Amen.
With the risen life of Christ within you, go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.